Now, amongst other things on the programme today, we're hearing from a grieving mother. Have a listen to this.
I am the mother of a dead child. There, I've written those dreaded words, the worst nightmare of every loving parent. Stark prose from which most adults recoil, whether they are child-free or a parent. My son Andrew was killed, age 24, in 2007. His sister Emma was just 17 when she lost her only sibling. Yet Emma remains Andrew's sister, and I still remain a mother of two. We belong to a growing club whose membership runs into the tens of thousands across the UK.
That's Christine Lord from Southsea, who's published a powerful article called Lost for Words. It looks at how society tries to silence parents in her position. And she joins me this morning in our Gunwharf Quay studio here in Portsmouth. Good morning, Christine.
Good morning, Julian. Thank you for having me on your show. And thank you for your listeners to listen to me.
No, pleasure. And what made you write this article? And I know you feel strongly that, you know, everybody else has a kind of time limit on grief.
Well, we will all suffer loss. All of us will suffer some sort of loss and some sort of bereavement, and we will all eventually die. And I just wanted to start this conversation because of my own experience. And as a journalist, I've interviewed bereaved parents up and down the UK and abroad, and they all actually say similar things to me. Child bereavement is almost like a taboo, and once the funeral's over, people are expected not to talk about that child. Now, I'm actually hoping that this will engage people to think about it and engage debate, actually. And I want to start this conversation about child bereavement and how society and the public fear of strong emotions, their own mostly, actually get us to almost censor what we're talking about. Mm. For example, we're talking about recently, obviously, the new royal birth with Kate and William. So in offices up and down the country, shops, everywhere, probably people are talking about their children. Oh, my child weighed this at this, you know, when they were born. Like, I have a daughter, I say my daughter was 8 pounds and Andrew was nearly 8 pounds. And when I talk about my Emma, who is alive, that's fine. But as soon as I actually start talking about Andrew, who is dead, even in very uplifting and celebratory ways, this conversation becomes awkward and other people become very awkward and embarrassed. And it's very much like that I have to censor what I'm talking about when I very much want to include Andrew in everyday conversations. He will always be part of my life. He will always be my son and he will always be my family.
And do you, in that circumstance where, for example, you're talking about Emma and Andrew, yeah, once that people realise Andrew is no longer with us, what would you like people to do, or but how would you like them to behave?
Well, I would like them to think, wow, how am I feeling now? I'm feeling awkward, or I'm feeling embarrassed, or I feel shocked that this mother is still talking about her child. Because this is another thing, we live in a very quick fix, fast-paced society, and people think that after a certain time you get over it. You never get over losing a child. So I would like people to actually reminisce with me, talk, engage, just general chat and conversation that we have every day, you know.
Yeah,
every,
so not close every, it down, in other words.
Yes, and not yeah. close it down. So I think, you know, this is a really important issue and a really important, you know, difficulty, because every year, 9,000 young people under 30 die in the UK, and that's an average that has stuck for the last 4 or 5 years, and it probably will continue. So we're talking tens of thousands of parents or guardians that are in this position that
who've
I'm
been
in.
Through it. Yes,
yeah,
exactly.
And also, you know, Andrew died a decade ago, and I get people say, well, aren't you over that? Haven't you moved forward? And it's almost like, well, I can't move forward, I move along. Yes. Andrew is still part of me, and I like to talk about him, you know, when it's needed. I don't endlessly talk about either of my children, but I like to just to engage in a conversation. And if kids come up or family come up, include him if it's appropriate without people thinking, oh my God, I'm going to upset her. Oh my God, this has ruined my day. I don't want to think about a dead child, because unfortunately I hold a mirror up to most parents' worst nightmare. And I think it's not only good for my mental health, but it's actually good for everybody's mental health
and
well-being.
To think about it. Yes,
to think about it.
And you talk about people's sympathy coming with an expiry date. So do you think people have a period of time that they allow you to be grieving, and then it suddenly, as you mentioned a moment ago, haven't you got over it yet, or you know, or you must have moved on now, or what do you find?
Yes, I do, and I think, you know, part of it is the society that we live in. You know, we watch our soap. Somebody, a young character, may die on the soap, and within a couple of weeks or a month, the family is different, and you know, nobody talks about that person anymore. And I think also it's a general fear of actually child bereavement, particularly because, you know, children shouldn't die before their parents. It is an awful catastrophe for me, but I'm talking about when I want to talk about fun things that my son did,
yeah,
what he achieved, the people that he met, you know, just an everyday chatter, whether, you know, what he was like as a teenager, moody, whatever. And I am actually censoring a lot of my conversations because I understand that people are getting upset about it, or they think they don't want to talk about it. And I think, you know, this is a really big issue because all of us will have some sort of bereavement, whether it's a sibling that may die or a young person that we know that may die. And I think it's important that we celebrate our children and our young people.
Indeed. And look, before I let you go, Christine, let's just talk about Andrew, because I know that in a way that's the spirit of what you're saying. And, you know, what was he like?
Well, he was a lovely young man, as you know, your listeners know. He had a wonderful job in the media. He did lots of things for lots of people. He produced programmes for Sky, Talk Sport, and he had a big circle of friends. And you know, it's not just me. I interviewed, you know, quite a few people, including men, and men would say that they'd actually taken down photographs at their office because clients would come in and they'd talk about family. And when, you know, this particular guy Nicholas talked about his family, it would all get so awkward that he actually had to take a photograph down of his bereaved child.
That's sad, isn't it? That is very sad.
Yeah, and it's also about, you know, our children did exist. They were part of society, and it's about celebrating our kids.
Well, Christine, you've done just that with memories of Andrew there, and I know your article is published today on starandcrescent.org.uk, which is a website with news and features for the Portsmouth area. Thank you for joining us this morning, Christine. I'm really grateful to you.
Thank you.